As mentioned previously, we use kinematics to analyze the motion of an object. In this video, we'll talk about the simpler case of one-dimensional motion. Later, we'll talk about the two-dimensional applications. I also indicated previously that the basic strategy for kinematics is to throw the variables into a set of equations and then solve those equations for the unknown. To do this, we'll deal with five variables. The five variables are displacement, initial velocity, final velocity, acceleration, and time. I could have actually written delta x as x final minus x initial, and some people do that, and then you just say that there are five variables. This is just my preference to do it with just delta x. One thing that happens at this point is that some of the variables get renamed. Frankly, it's too bad that this happens, but it's just done for historical reasons and we're stuck with it. The first thing we'll do is indicate that the initial time is zero. Once we've done that, then delta t is just t final, and then t final is actually renamed as t without a subscript. Also, the initial velocity is rewritten as v naught, and that's because we're calling the initial time zero, so we give v a zero subscript. And then also, the final velocity is written as just v. So what we'll do then is replace these variables with the renamed variables. So the five variables then are written this way. Okay, so now we want to look at the kinematic equations, and there are five of them. Many textbooks, including ours, actually just list three or four equations, but my preference is to use five. I believe it's cleaner and more logical to deal with a set of five equations. On a side note, physics is generally easier and less confusing if you limit the number of equations, and I'm a big proponent of that. But this would be one of the rare exceptions to that rule. Okay, so the five equations come from equations we already know, plus a little math. The basic derivation is to start with the average velocity, the average acceleration, and the mathematical definition of average or a mean. Now, this definition for a mean or an average, it's actually only true if velocity is a straight line, or in math, a linear line is a straight line. Let me give you a quick explanation about why that's so, why velocity needs to be a straight or linear line. Say you're driving your car at 20 miles per hour for a long time and only briefly jump up to 40 miles per hour. If you plot it out over time, it might look something like this. You can imagine that your average speed, or the mean speed for the trip, is not right in the middle of 20 and 40, which is what the equation produces. The mean or the average would actually be much closer to 20 in this case. So this equation that we want to use is not valid for this curve. But let's say instead you start at 20 miles per hour and steadily increase to 40 miles per hour linearly. So it looks like this. So now the average is right in the center of 20 and 40. It's 30. And that's what this equation gives us. So now the equation is valid for this linear line or this straight line. Another important point to make here is recall that the acceleration is the slope of the VT plot, and this is a VT plot. So since this is a straight line, then the slope is constant. So that means the acceleration associated with this plot is also constant. So now back to the previous slide. It's more useful to say that this equation, instead of saying that it's valid when the velocity is a straight line, I think it's a little more useful to say it's valid when the acceleration is constant, and that's what we'll normally do. Now back to the derivation. The first one is really easy. It's just a rewrite of the average acceleration equation. Let's first replace delta v with final minus initial. And since the acceleration is constant, we don't need the bar over the top of the acceleration anymore indicating average, so let's remove it. Let's next rewrite the variables with the new nomenclature as we had just discussed, and then solve this equation for the final velocity. The result is the first kinematic equation. I won't go through the remaining derivations. They're all just combinations of the three equations, the one for average velocity, average acceleration, and the mathematical definition of what a mean is or an average is. All of that work is in the textbook, but here are the final results, the final five kinematic equations. I've written these assuming that the direction of motion is in the x direction. If the motion is in the y or the z direction, just replace the x variable with y or z. An important thing to note at this stage when using these equations is that they're only valid when the acceleration is constant. And this is because we used the one equation for the average velocity that was only valid when the acceleration was constant. And so that means that all of these other equations that are derivations from that are also only valid when the acceleration is constant. So we'll come across applications later in the course where the acceleration is not constant. And when we do that, we'll need to have other techniques to deal with that. But there are many cases in nature where the acceleration is constant, or at least can be approximated to be constant. A very common case is the acceleration due to gravity, due to the force of gravity. So anyway, back to the equations. If you look closely at the variables involved, you'll notice that each one is missing one of the five variables. The first one is missing delta x, the second one is missing the final velocity, and so on. This is why I like to use five kinematic equations. I think it makes for a very clean and logical set to use. When you're solving a problem, just determine which variable is not involved in the problem, and then that'll tell you which of these five equations to use. Next, let me give you a procedure for 1D kinematic problems. So this is my version of the procedure. The one in the textbook is a little bit different, but the main components are the same. So first, draw a simple diagram that shows the coordinate scheme, the initial and final positions of the object, and show the key variables on the diagram, and especially show the directions for the vectors, like displacement and velocity and acceleration. That's pretty important because then when you apply them to the equation, showing the directions are going to help you get the signs right. Next, list the five variables and include any of the known values. So if you know what the acceleration is, or you know what the velocity is, the initial velocity, go ahead and write that on the diagram. Then you can choose the correct kinematic equation to use based on the list that you just created, and then you can solve it for the appropriate unknown. Finally, check to see if your answer is reasonable. You know, if you solve for the velocity of your car and it turns out to be faster than the speed of light, maybe it's not right. Or you drop a baseball and it winds up higher than where it started, then you know you've made a mistake. Okay, finally, on the next slide, I'll work through an example one-dimensional kinematic problem that'll demonstrate this procedure. So here's our problem. A student holds a ball 5 meters above the floor and releases it. Another student has a stopwatch and records that it takes 1.0 seconds for the ball to hit the floor. Assuming that the ball's acceleration is constant, what is the magnitude of the acceleration? So we'll follow the procedure. The first step is to draw the diagram, put the coordinate scheme on here, mark the initial and final spots, And now start to put the variables on the diagram. So here's the displacement. We record that it's a negative 5 because it's going opposite the positive y direction. The initial velocity is 0, so that's implied in the problem. A lot of people might have overlooked that, but it's not moving initially, so the initial velocity is 0. The final velocity is unknown. The acceleration is unknown. Of course, that's what we're asked. What is the acceleration? And then the time is 1 second. So the second step is to list all of the variables. So even if they're not involved, I just go ahead and make the complete list of 5 variables. And then I plug in their numbers, or if I don't know what they are, I'll put a question mark. The acceleration is the one we're looking for. The other variable we don't know is not involved in the problem at all. I wasn't asked for it, and I don't know any values for it. So that's the one we don't care about. So in step 3, we know which equation to pick. It's the one that does not have final velocity. And there's the equation. The general way to solve an equation, the standard way to do it, is to solve for the unknown, leaving everything as a variable, and then plugging in the numbers at the very end. The reason why you want to do that is because a lot of times variables will cancel out and drop out of the equation. However, one thing I do like to do before I do that is to zero anything out. I'll look for anything that's 0 and cancel it out or mark it out. And that just simplifies the algebra we have to do next. So now we'll go ahead and solve it for the acceleration. Plug in the numbers, solve that. So there's the answer. The acceleration is negative 10. Is that reasonable? Well, you may not know that 10 meters per second squared is a reasonable number or not. But the fact that it's negative is actually a good sign, because if we look back at the diagram, we see that we marked the acceleration going down. So that would be the negative direction. Now notice that what we were asked for is the magnitude. So the actual answer is positive 10, because a magnitude is always a positive number, just by definition. And especially if you're doing a question like this in WebAssign, if they ask for a magnitude, that means by definition you're putting in a positive number. All right, so that's it for 1D kinematics, and the next stop, 2D kinematics.